Welcome, investors, to the Absolute Return Podcast, your source for stock market analysis, global macro musings, and hedge fund investment strategies. Your hosts, Julian Klimochko and Michael Kesslering, aim to bring you the knowledge and analysis you need to become a more intelligent and wealthier investor. This episode is brought to you by Accelerate Financial Technologies. Accelerate, because performance matters. Find out more at accelerateshares.com.
Welcome, podcast listeners, to episode 114 of the Absolute Return podcast. I am Julian Klimochko.
And I'm Mike Kessler.
Today is a chilly Saturday, February 6th, 2021. A few things to chat about happening in the markets this week. Number one, we wanted to chat about a short seller report, Hindenburg Research. They launched a scathing attack on newly public company Clover Health. What does the market think of the accusations here, and how did the company respond? Jeff Bezos retires as Amazon CEO, passing the torch to Andy Jassy. Was Bezos the greatest CEO of all time? And lastly, payments firm Payoneer to go public through SPAC FTAC Olympus acquisition. Did the market like this deal? But Mike, let's touch on this activist short seller report from Hindenburg Research. I should note that they were actually not even short the stock. They just, I guess, put it out for fun. But nonetheless, they published a report critical of Clover Health, which recently went public just in October through blank check company Social Capital Hedosophia 3. Now, a bit about this company, Clover. They sell Medicare-backed insurance plans. Some details on the recent going public transaction. It was a $3.7 billion deal through a SPAC backed by none other than Chamath Palihapitiya, who's catching quite a bit of flack here from Hindenburg Research. This SPAC raised $720 million in April 2020, announced the deal 6 months later, the tie-up with Clover. Some background on what Chamath got from this deal. He got over 20 million founders shares, basically free shares worth nearly $300 million. So not a bad payday for him for putting this deal together. However, Hindenburg accuses Chamath of misleading investors regarding Clover's prospects and called the company a, quote, broken business. Additionally, they say that Clover Health is under active investigation by the DOJ Department of Justice, which the company did confirm. Apparently, the DOJ is looking into at least 12 issues, including kickbacks, unsound marketing practices, and undisclosed third-party deals. The report did also detail poor reviews from some health practitioners on the quality of the product. But nonetheless, Clover did respond to the accusations with a very in-depth rebuttal, which is nice. Too often you see companies just go after the short seller without actually looking at the substance of their report. So it's very nice to check out the 8K that Clover put out, going through kind of line by line of all the accusation. But their stock still dropped this week, down about 8.4%. on the news. Mike, what are your thoughts on this interesting research report from Hindenburg? I should touch on what we discussed last week, which is, you know, my thesis was we wouldn't really see these much anymore, just given this whole crew of Wall Street Bets guys looking to target short sellers. But thus far, they haven't really gone after Hindenburg or Clover trying to cause a short squeeze. They still seem focused on GameStop, or should I say GameStonk?
Well, yeah, and I mean, I guess that's part of it is Hindenburg is kind of treading pretty carefully here because, as you mentioned, like they don't hold a short position
right
with Clover. And I think this is really just them doing PR for short sellers everywhere.
Yeah, that's a good point.
They mentioned that the goal of this was to show that short sellers do have a major role in exposing fraud and corporate malfeasance. So, I mean, they're looking to raise the profile of both themselves and I guess earn back some of the profile for the short sellers in general. And I mean, in terms of short sellers, Hindenburg is of pretty decent quality for their short seller reports. I mean, they were responsible for the Nikola short seller report, which was very entertaining.
Yeah, and some details on that one where they called Nikola an intricate fraud built on dozens of lies. And one specifically was where they detailed the Nikola semi-truck rolling down a hill and it didn't even have an engine. It was just rolling due to gravity and not powering by its supposed electric vehicle engine.
That was one of the more entertaining reports in general, not just short reports, that report was absolutely entertaining, where they talked about how they basically just had a rendering group as opposed to actual engineering at Nikola. But back to Clover, I mean, you hit the nail on the head as well. Is what I really enjoy this situation, because Clover actually came back with a solid rebuttal. And then after that, Hindenburg came back with another rebuttal of their own, but it kind of lacked a little bit of meat. There wasn't too much to it on Friday. But really, like, Clover, they acknowledged the main crux of what Hindenburg was going after them for were these requests for information. And
from the DOJ.
Yes, exactly. From the DOJ. And I'm not a lawyer and don't profess to be an expert on the subject, but I do believe that what this is coming down to is the difference between requests for information and actual accusations of wrongdoing. As I do understand that, you know, they are a highly regulated company, being a part of Medicare. So they do receive, at least the company says, they do receive these types of requests on the, it's a very normal course business. So in that sense, I can kind of be on board where they would say, hey, this isn't material. This doesn't need to be disclosed to shareholders. Obviously, Hindenburg thinks that there's more to this, right, and that's just a sign that there actually will be charges brought against them. I really don't know, but I do like the fact that they're going back and forth. And what Hindenburg did say, part of their goal was to that they thought that Clover wasn't being transparent. Well, their actions over the last week have made Clover become more transparent. Now everything's being discussed out in the open for investors to make a decision. And I mean, given the price reaction of Clover, I mean, it was trading at about just above $14 prior to the short report, then was trading below $13 for most of Friday before kind of rebounding up to almost $13. Or it was trading below $12 and then traded up to almost $13 by the end of day on Friday. I mean, investors now, it seems, are taking into account this information.
Right.
And it doesn't seem to be a death blow for the company, at least at this point with the current information available. But an interesting situation. It's making things more transparent in the market, and it's an open dialogue between the two.
It's a good point you make with respect to regulatory investigations. And in certain businesses, that's normal course. I'm not saying this is necessarily the case, but in healthcare, it does happen often. One analogous situation would be in technology. I mean, Google and Facebook, tremendously successful and profitable, but getting investigated and fined by regulators to the tune of multiple billions of dollars just seems par for the course in that business. And the other point that you made was hedge funds and short sellers have really been unnecessarily or unjustifiably demonized over the past number of months, which in my opinion doesn't make sense. Historically, they have been the sheriffs of Wall Street, you know, sniffing out fraud and things of that nature. And it wasn't too long ago where the movie The Big Short came out with Christian Bale, Steve Carell, Ryan Gosling, Brad Pitt, and they were heralded as heroes and lionized. So I don't know when that happened, when hedge funds went from hedge funds short sellers went from having movies being made about them to retail traders wanting to go after them and blow them up. But nonetheless, this one is looking like a PR stunt from Hindenburg. So investors should note they don't necessarily have skin in the game. However, you know, it's worthwhile reading the report, doing your own due diligence, and making your own decision on this one. And now, a word from our sponsor, Accelerate, one of Canada's most innovative and fastest-growing alternative investment solution providers, with a suite of institutional-caliber alternative ETFs for investors seeking diversification and long-term performance. The Accelerate Arbitrage Fund, symbol ARB on the TSX, is the world's first SPAC-focused ETF with a diversified portfolio of SPAC and merger arbitrage opportunities in an easy-to-use, low-cost ETF. The Accelerate Arbitrage Fund ETF trades under the symbol ARB on the Toronto Stock Exchange. Find out more at accelerateshares.com. On to some big news out of Amazon. Jeff Bezos, who is often regarded as the best or was best CEO in the world. And that's he's stepping down from his executive position at Amazon. So Bezos, he's 57. So somewhat surprising, but I guess not so surprising when he's the richest man in the world. Perhaps he's accomplished everything he wanted to do in that side of his life. He founded Amazon in 1994, so it's been quite the ride. Turned it into a $1.7 trillion behemoth, the second largest company in the world. So kudos to him for that massive accomplishment and made himself the richest man in the world. In the process, I think he's worth about $200 billion or so. He pioneered basically two industries, in addition to a myriad of others, but mostly online retail. Amazon.com, huge seller, as everyone knows, but also cloud storage with their Amazon Web Services. So what Bezos is going to do, he's transitioning to executive chair and passing the reins of the company to his lieutenant, Andy Jassy, in Q3 of this year, so in a few months. But Bezos, he's not fading away. He said he will stay engaged in important Amazon projects, but will also have more time to focus on the Bezos Earth Fund, his Blue Origin spaceship company, which he funds to the tune of billions of dollars per year, the Washington Post, which he owns, and the Amazon Day One Fund. Some background on the upcoming CEO. Jassy joined Amazon in 1997, so was very early, came to the company just a few years after its founding, and he led Amazon's Web Services cloud team since its inception, which was obviously a massive part of Amazon and a key growth driver of Amazon's financial performance. And in my opinion, and many analysts' opinion, the majority of Amazon's current value. For example, about 50% of Amazon's operating income was attributed to Amazon Web Services just as of the fourth quarter in 2020. So tremendously profitable, massive business for Amazon Web Services. So it appears like Jassy certainly has the chops to fill some tough shoes to fill. What do you think of this somewhat surprising, but news that was expected at some point?
Yeah, certainly the timing may be surprising, but as you mentioned, expected
Yeah, it's not always too surprising point. When the stock's at all-time highs. It's always a good time.
Yeah, no. I guess to our knowledge, nothing immediate on the horizon that would warrant Bezos stepping down. But I mean, he's viewed as somewhat of a micromanager for projects that he cares deeply about. So the situation really is just reminiscent of when Bill Gates stepped down from Microsoft for Steve Ballmer to take over. I mean, Gates after that still had pretty heavy involvement in certain projects and strategy, but just less of the day-to-day. So it kind of makes sense from Bezos's standpoint. But with regards to Jassy, I mean, yeah, he was really the founder of Amazon Web Services within Amazon. The interesting aspect is that prior to that, he was basically Jeff Bezos's chief of staff for about 18 months, I think it was, kind of his technical assistant, a role that had been filled by a number of different founders from companies that Amazon had acquired, and it never really worked out very well. But Jassy, it seems it worked out very well for him, as he immediately transitioned into what would soon become, over the next decade or so, the largest part of Amazon's business in terms of value creation. He also has a similar style, according to insiders, where he's extremely customer-centric. So in terms of Amazon's general strategy, I don't think we can expect a lot of change there. Like AWS, just in terms of their position, I mean, you mentioned the fact that they make up the majority of the Amazon profit, despite only being 12% of total revenue. And I mean, the interesting aspect of that is, they're the most important aspect, arguably, of the world's largest company, but they also have a ton of runway within cloud computing. I mean, they have first mover advantage, and I believe they have about 45% market share, followed by Microsoft and Google at substantially less. But they're growing at a massive rate. So to be that profitable and still growing at a massive rate with a large total addressable market is very interesting, and no doubt is why Bezos would choose him over another segment had. And I, one last thing just to mention, I mean, for some of our hockey fans as well, I would note that he is a part owner of the upcoming expansion team, the Seattle Kraken. So there is a little bit of tie-in for some of our sports fans here as well.
Nice. Well, there you have it. Before wrapping up this file, I wanted to just have a highlight from the statement Jeff Bezos released to Amazon employees. The last part of it, it stated, quote, "Keep inventing and don't despair when at first the idea looks crazy. Remember to wander. Let curiosity be your compass. It remains day one." Pretty epic. And in my opinion, the greatest CEO of all time. So kudos to Bezos. He'll be studied by business schools, management, and investors for years to come. And market reaction, fairly muted. Amazon was up 3.4% this week, kind of in line with the market. And now a word from our sponsor, Accelerate, one of Canada's most innovative and fastest growing alternative investment solution providers, with a suite of institutional caliber alternative ETFs for investors seeking diversification and long-term performance. The Accelerate One Choice Alternative Portfolio ETF, symbol 1C, ONEC on the TSX, is Canada's first alternatives portfolio solution, providing exposure to 6 alternative asset classes, 10 alternative strategies, in one easy-to-use, one-choice ETF that charges a management fee of just 0.2%. The Accelerate One Choice Alternative Portfolio ETF trades under the symbol 1C, ONEC on the Toronto Stock Exchange. Find out more at accelerateshares.com. Lastly, let's chat about a SPAC deal. Online payment company Payoneer, they announced a business combination with Blank Check Company. This is a long one. SPACs these days typically have pretty long names. This one is FTAC Olympus Acquisition Corporation. This deal valued the fintech startup Payoneer at $3.3 billion enterprise value. A bit of background on Payoneer, fairly established company founded in New York City in 2005, so about 16 years old. It provides businesses and professionals with cross-border payments platform and has about 4 million customers. The business is fairly established. It is profitable, adds over $400 million of revenue. And in terms of valuation on this deal, it's being done at a 7.6 times multiple of this year's revenue. A bit of different than what we're seeing in other SPAC deals where some of them are, you know, pre-profitability or even pre-revenue. So this is more of an established business. As part of the going public transaction, Payoneer is going to be cashed up. They're receiving over $250 million from the SPAC, in addition to $300 million from a PIPE financing that includes Wellington Management, Dragoneer Investment Group, Franklin Templeton, and Fidelity. So that PIPE was well subscribed. And this deal really just showcases the appeal of the blank check structure as the preferred method of going public. Year to date, I think over like 80 to 90% of the IPOs have been SPAC. So it's really just taking over the new issuance market. And I did want to have a quote from FTAC sponsor, Betsy Cohen, which I think this is a winning deal from her. She stated, "Payoneer is at the forefront of the rapid global shift to digital commerce across all sectors. Its innovative and unique high-tech, high-touch platform positions Payoneer at the epicenter of some of the most powerful and enduring trends driving global commerce today." So I think this is a win for Betsy Cohen. She has had, if you look at the, she's got multiple SPACs. If you look at the last one she did with Perella Weinberg, which in my opinion was kind of a dud because that's more of like a no-growth business and not really what SPAC investors are looking for. But I think Payoneer provides the right combination of profitability and growth and a long runway, total addressable market, and things of that nature. So yeah, it's worthwhile paying attention to this FTAC Payoneer deal. We are long, got to disclose, in the Accelerate Arbitrage Fund, been long this SPAC since at least around the IPO. And if we look at the SPAC action this week, it was pretty incredible. Not only were there just a tremendous amount of IPOs, but a ton of business combinations too. There are 8 SPAC business combinations announced this week for a total enterprise value, total deal value of $52.7 billion. So pretty massive news week in terms of SPACs. Wanted to highlight this transaction because it does have some unique features. Market didn't go bananas, but they did like it. I mean, FTX stock was up 10% this week on the news, outperforming. Mike, what are your thoughts on this interesting Payoneer deal?
Yeah, first, just back to your comment around her previous SPAC with Perella, taking Perella public. The irony of an investment bank using a SPAC to go public as opposed to a traditional IPO, which obviously investment banks are involved in SPACs and it's quite lucrative for them.
Yep.
But with the traditional bread and butter of IPOs for investment banks, very ironic that they would choose the SPAC process. I feel like that's kind of a very negative sentiment towards IPOs to have an actual investment bank go public via SPAC. But back to Payoneer, I mean, interesting deal. I think you mentioned the key points on the actual deal itself. Like, I mean, the PIPE financing, it has kind of a who's who of the traditional PIPE investors. So nothing too exciting there. And especially from, I mean, Betsy Cohen is part of the establishment within the financial services sector. So no, not surprising at all that she would be able to get all these reputable institutions on board for the financing. But more on Betsy Cohen, because, I mean, she is someone within the banking community that perhaps is a little less known to our investors, but has had a very prolific career where, I mean, most recently, she was the former CEO and founder of the bank, Bancorp Bank, but also was the founder of Jefferson Bank that was acquired for, I believe, over $300 million back in 1999. So, I mean, her roots in the banking establishment are quite strong. And then, as you had mentioned, this is her fourth SPAC. So she's very experienced within SPACs. She was a very early adopter of SPACs as a vehicle to go public. So, I mean, just her background is very interesting to follow. And that's the benefit of following the SPAC sector is many of these sponsors do have very interesting backgrounds and are quite prolific themselves. So just even reading through the filing statements, you're able to learn a little bit more about the history of some of these individuals, which is, I mean, always interesting as an investor.
And the SPAC space remains extremely busy. IPOs, M&A, a ton of stuff going on. So I encourage investors to give us a follow on Twitter because we do produce a ton of research and content and follow every deal in the SPAC space. So before we wrap things up today, Mike, where can investors follow you on the Twitter machine?
They can follow me at m_Kessler.
And my tweet handle is at Julian Klimochko. That wraps it up for episode 114 of the Absolute Return podcast. If you enjoyed it, definitely leave us a review. You can check out more episodes at absolutereturnpodcast.com. Really excited for some upcoming guests on the podcast. Got a number booked, so that should be cool. Until next week, wish you all the best in your investing, and we'll chat with you soon. Cheers.
Thanks for tuning in to the Absolute Return Podcast. This episode was brought to you by Accelerate Financial Technologies. Accelerate, because performance matters. Find out more at accelerateshares.com. The views expressed in this podcast are the personal views of the participants and do not reflect the views of Accelerate. No aspect of this podcast constitutes investment, legal, or tax advice. Opinions expressed in this podcast should not be viewed as a recommendation or solicitation of an offer to buy or sell any securities or investment strategies. The information and opinions in this podcast are based on current market conditions and may fluctuate and change in the future. No representation or warranty expressed or implied is made on behalf of Accelerate as to the accuracy or completeness of the information contained in this podcast. Accelerate does not accept any liability for any direct, indirect, or consequential loss or damage suffered by any person as a result of relying on all or any part of this podcast, and any liability is expressly disclaimed.